Now this morning we're going to continue our teachings on the Cether. We're coming to the conclusion of these teachings, but remember, to conclude a teaching doesn't mean you conclude. The act of living out what you have read, heard, and listened to for all these weeks. Now, last week when we were here, we went to the place that I'd written and taught about in the newsletter on having to stay long enough to bloom where you're planted. God wants you to bloom where you are planted. But this takes a lot of Holy Spirit unction on the inside of you to remain committed to what God wants you to have and to enjoy. When you look at people who claim we want to bloom where we are planted, there are certain things that you find which is impressed into their heart and which God the Spirit quickens into their hearts. And it's so real that it's much like what you read of in Isaiah chapter 56. The first thing that you begin to see is God leads a person into deeper worship and actually love times with Him. That's what worship is. Worship is not saying praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord three times. And anything more than that is a waste of time. Worship is the longer time I spend with Him, I come out the better. Better off in many respects. My life is transformed. My life is changed. I'm no longer the one I used to be like. Now I'm a different man. Now I'm a different individual. Some of you had a smile on your face when you were listening to what it is to go in an aircraft which is hitting turbulence. One time I heard Jesse Duplantis speak about it. He said, even a Baptist won't have a problem with speaking in tongues when the plane hits air turbulence. A staunch Baptist will start praying out however you want him to pray when the plane hits real turbulence. Because most people think it is only the rattling and the shaking. Of course, that's more than enough, but there's another aspect of hitting air turbulence that very few people actually know of. The plane falling a couple of hundreds of feet. They don't tell you this before you board the flight. But that's what happens. And unless we hear the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob by our side, all the time, the panic ratio in our hearts is not reduced. God knew exactly what He was speaking of when He said, His glory will be with us as the re-reward in our journeyings. If you listen to me on the 1st of 2009, I went on repeating that word. I said not journey, journeyings. Most people didn't know what I was talking about. But thank God, God knew. The wisdom of God knew exactly what it would entail as the year progressed. There would be rebuilding. There would be restoration. There would be His glorious re-reward. But there would also be renewal. Now it is in the aspect of renewal that you see the principle of blooming where you are planted begins to manifest. Unless there is a renewal in your heart and in your mind, you will not give yourself enough time to bloom. And I want you to write it down, please. Give yourself enough time to bloom. Don't be in a hurry. Give yourself enough time to bloom. Most uproot themselves the moment they think they're not capable of blooming. I'm amazed at what God did this morning. I was speaking to a young man, praying with him, and I mentioned two things. Spoke about Joseph, and I spoke about the flesh. You listen clearly to the prayer that was prayed at the beginning of the service. It had to do with destroying the flesh, a fast according to the Joseph's fast. Now, you must understand, this is not possible unless you spend time with God. You can't just come up and speak something that is exactly a confirmation of what God is speaking to another person, unless you spend time with Him in prayer. Worship is least understood in the body of Christ. That's why you find people looking at worship as though it is something that is not that important. They don't consider it as important. And the reason they don't consider it as important is because of their own understanding of what it does in their lives. But if you are to bloom where you are planted, you must know the scriptures teaches that worship is a part and parcel of forming the foundation to staying put in one place. You look at Psalm 1, the beginning of Psalms. The Bible talks about the word blessed is the man. One of the most amazing things of the blessedness of the man who avoids three kinds of people and places himself in the right place is the key to understanding how I can bloom where God plants me. One of the major areas in which the children of Israel were guilty about was that they were spiritually walking around not understanding the blessedness of the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, doesn't put himself in the way of sinners, or even sits in the seat of the scornful. All through you read in the Bible, you will find of how Israel lived a life of utter debauchery spiritually. If they would come into contact with the Canaanites, they would learn the way of the Canaanites. If they would come into contact with the Assyrians, they would learn the ways of the Assyrians. Spiritually, they would prostitute themselves to the highest bidder for personal gain. I want you to write what I'm saying. I'm not talking stories. When you talk about harlotry, you're talking about how you position yourself. Because harlots position themselves and ask for something. You look at the blessedness of the man who brings forth his fruit in his season. He has to be planted by the rivers of water. He has to be a person who's planted, not uprooted. He should make himself available to be in the place where God wants him to be, where there is a constant flow of living truth. Write this down, please. Living truth. Be available in a place where you are fed constantly on living truth. You know why I am talking about this? Because unless living truth penetrates your heart, stagnant waters will make your root die and rot. That's why crop are left too long on stagnant water. They will not bring forth anything. That's why the Bible tells us in Psalm 1. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 1, please. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Be like a tree. God means for you to be like a tree. God doesn't want you to be just a sapling all your lifetime. A tree takes time to grow. A tree takes time to bring forth. A tree takes time to bring the harvest forth. Give yourself an opportunity to grow. I want you to write in your notes, give yourself enough time to bloom. Give yourself enough time to grow. Two things. That's why the Cether experience is not a fun time. If you ask me that 1 hour or 1.5 hours of travel on the plane, if you're a frequent visitor of places and it entails that you have to travel where you're not actually piloting the craft, can become your place of Cether, where the Lord begins to deal with you one-on-one. Sure, there will be the ones who read the newspapers. There will be the others who find great joy in doing a lot of other things, sleeping for example, catching up on what they couldn't get at other times. But a man who is spiritually sensitive to God prepares himself for the Cether experience, because he believes it's a place of growth, not a place where he begins to die. He begins to grow. Now God has different places where he places his people, where the nature of their growth becomes noticeable as they abide where he wants them to be. You have to abide where God wants you to be. He wants you to give yourself enough time to grow. Give yourself enough time to bloom where you are planted. That's why I told you when we spoke about it last week, this is not a Christian cliche. Christian cliches will not stand the test of time. Christian cliches will be nothing when the storm begins to blow. Remember, the storm blew on both people's houses. It beat hard and strong on both the houses built by both the men. The one who had built it on the rock and the one who had built it on the sand. Christian cliches are the equivalent of building a house on sand. It'll fall. The intensity of the storm will not change. Write it down, please. Because sometimes people ask questions, what did I do to go through this? Well, you don't have to do anything to go through anything. By virtue of you being born into this world, you and I qualify to face the storms of life. That's why I've always mentioned this, and I've mentioned it quite a number of times here as well. Bad things happen to bad people, but there are times when bad things happen to good people also. I don't hear you. It's up to you whether you want to accept that or not, but there are times when bad things happen to good people. But the outcome of what happens doesn't rest with the bad that has happened. It rests with the one who is able to say, I planted myself by the rivers of living water. That's why I am what I am today. Take the example of Job, please. I am speaking by the revelation of God, and I want you to write down example Job. The next time you're tempted to ask the question, what did I do wrong? You must know that bad things happen to good people also. But the outcome rests with a man who abides in the right place. I've always been fascinated when I first started teaching about this in our Sunday Tamil service, the second service, on the life of this man Job. He was what you would call an ultra-sensitive man to God. He knew his children were partying. He knew what happens when people party over a limit. Somewhere along the line, a wrong confession, a wrong word. In the midst of celebration, a loose joke. A degeneration of the glory and honor that must be God's at all times happens when a loose joke is pronounced or let loose in a time of celebration that gives the wrong impression to people. Job knew it well. The Bible says he was always sacrificing, because he said, in the event my children have sinned, I don't want God to hold it against them. I want to show you something. Who died and who made it? I'm again going to repeat. Who died and who made it? They were all together in the eldest boy's house partying, when a strong wind came. Do I hear an amen from this church? How many of you read your Bibles real good? The man who kept sacrificing lived. Maybe he had to go through tremendous pain, but he lived, he made it. Come with me to the book of Job. Sometimes, by virtue of you just spending time before God, people will mock you, because it doesn't align with their value system. You're a prayerful man in business, it doesn't value with their system of belief. So they'll mock you. They'll scorn you. They'll laugh at you. They'll make a mockery of everything you do. But let me show this to you from the book of Job, please. Job chapter 1. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, everyone his day. That means all the time, so much of money, so much of wealth in their hands. And sent and called for their sisters. Now the sisters were minding their own business. They wouldn't leave them. Come. To eat and to drink with them. Not one of them called them for prayer. I want you to write it down right there. For feasting, they made themselves available. For prayer, somehow, they weren't available. Lest you think I'm writing a new revelation to this. No, I'm going to show this to you. The sons of Job made themselves available to feasting. Isn't it amazing that not one of them got up early to join Job when he offered the sacrifice? Do you hear people this morning? Don't be surprised when some people fall and never get up. Don't be surprised when you fall and you get up. There is a difference between a man who prays and a man who doesn't pray. There is a difference between a woman who prays and a woman who doesn't pray. There is a difference between a child who prays and a child who doesn't pray. Look at Job, please. And it was so when the days of their feasting were gone about that Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. He had to call them. They wouldn't come. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. They were interested in the feasting. He was interested in the fellowshipping. He wanted fellowship with God more than fellowship with man. Because he knew in the absence of God in a time of celebration, something wrong will take place. Something wrong. Some boy will crack a loose joke. I mean, we have been in parties. We have been in times of celebration. We have seen this happen all the time. Someone or other cracks a joke which is out of beat with the spirit of the celebration. And if that person is not immediately brought to check, that person starts progressing down that road. And sooner or later, God bears the brunt of the attack. Now let's read, please. Verse 13. And there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine in the eldest brother's house. Do you see that? It didn't happen when they were standing around the altar sacrificing. When they went back to what they liked, they longed for that. I want you to write it down. There's nothing wrong with celebration. There is nothing wrong with partying. But when that takes precedence and you're willing to plant yourself there rather in the place where the living water of God is flowing, then you have a problem. You have a problem. And there came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside them, and the Sabians fell upon them and took them away. Yea, they have slain thy servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the fire of God is fallen from heaven and it burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, came also another and said, the Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away. Yea, and slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking. I mean, this is one horrible attack from hell. There came also another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were sacrificing. No. Were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. Behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness. I wanted to make a note of this, please. I mean, when you read the Bible the right way, you will understand a lot of things that happen in life. There came a great wind from the wilderness. Now the great wind from the wilderness struck people who are in the wilderness spiritually. And smote the four corners of the house. And it fell upon the young men. And they are dead. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Now isn't it amazing that all through that we read, in the feasting, Job was never present. Have you ever thought about it? Is it because he was such a sour puss that he didn't want to go and sit and feast? He knew what mattered in life. The same in your life as well. You must know what matters. You must know what takes priority. You can't sit and act, because when the wind blows, it really blows. The four corners of the house came crashing down. Not only did the sons die, the daughters died as well. But Job was not there. Feasting, drinking wine was not a part of his lifestyle. He was the richest man in the East. But he was no fool. He knew if he had to keep his wealth, he had to stay connected with the God of wealth. That's why sometimes when you see people who don't understand the key to real success, we feel sad for these people. Because they're actually ignorant fools. They're under the impression that God is a God of poverty. Wrong. He's a God of prosperity. He's a God of untold wealth. We haven't even scratched the surface of the wealth that he's actually placed on the face of this earth. There are many places, they say, in the deepest parts of the oceans of the world that have never been seen by man, that have never been tapped with by man. It's sometimes so deep that it's hard to even reach. And they say there are reserves and reserves of oil there. Oil and water don't mix, but God's kept it in such a place that if you will pass through the water, you'll get at the oil. Hallelujah. That's the wisdom of God. And that makes foolish the rationalizing of man. That's why it's good for you to keep pressing on. Give yourself time to bloom where you're planted. Give yourself time. Don't write yourself off too quick. Don't say God's through with me because certain things didn't happen. The first 3 weeks I started believing. Keep pressing on. Someday you're going to see when the storm came, you made it. When the wind blew from the wilderness, you made it. Your house stood. Theirs fell. Because their priorities were different. Gluttony, my friends, has never been high priority in the sight of God. Can I have an amen from this church? Gluttony. So what do you get about the first group of children of Job? Were they hardworking children? Doesn't tell me that. What do we see of Job's first group of children? All the time eating and drinking. I said all the time eating and drinking. 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 This is what they focused on. This is what they loved. But the Cether of God is amazingly different. Can I have an amen, please? And I want you to write it down. Now look at what was happening. I'm going to show it to you in verse 20 because this was his lifestyle all the time. Look at verse 20. Then Job arose, rent his mantle, shaved his head, and fell down upon the ground. I want you to mark that, please. I want you to write this down, please. Give yourself enough time to grow. Give yourself enough time to bloom where you're planted. Because unless you know what God has ordained for you in life, where should you be? How should the flow of the Spirit of God be? You're not going to see the blessing come in your life. I want you to write it down, please. The sons of Job made it a habit to feast continually. I want you to write this down, please. Look at what Job was used to doing all the time. What was he used to doing all the time? I want you to write it down. All the time he was used to worshipping, praying. So he did that. He fell down upon the ground, worshipped and said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. Now this is not a philosophical statement. This man knew his origins. Write it down. A little bit of money, some people forget their origin. I mean, when they came out, they didn't come out with a three-piece suit. When they came out, they didn't come out with a gold spoon in their mouth, even though that's what they say. He was born with a silver spoon. They had to shove it into the man's mouth. How was this man? What made this man's life so tick that God would include his life in the Bible? Just think about it. A businessman, his life so impressed God that he would record it for us to learn from. He said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. Write it down. The Lord gave, and the Lord had taken away. Now we know that from reading this book, he had no revelation about God taking it. But one thing he was very clear, who gave? God gave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Empowered for good success is the name of the Lord. Now he was setting himself up for the next level of blessing. He knew his blessing will come. He knew something good will happen at the end of the day. Instead of cursing God, he would use his mouth and say, blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. That's the crux of understanding chapter 1. He never blamed God. Instead of blaming, he was worshipping. You look at a man who makes it his lifestyle to worship the Lord. Such a man always knows that his mouth was meant for better things than to curse God and die. Often people don't even respect their tongues. Their tongues were meant to be their glory. Their tongues were meant for better use than to curse God. Then I want you to see what happened a little later. Now, come with me a little down. Job, chapter 2. Verse 5 onwards. Put forth thine hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he'll curse thee to thy face. The Lord said unto Satan, behold, he is in thy hand, but save his life. Don't touch his life, because you're challenging me. I'm going to go through some of the hardest decisions I have to take. But this will turn out for glory later. So when Satan forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot unto his crown. So we know who brings sickness. We know who brings disease. It's not God. And he took him a potsherd to scrape himself with hell, and he sat down among the ashes. Then said his wife unto him. I want you to see what this woman did. This woman was not a very godly woman. But just because she positioned herself next to Job, she escaped. I want you to write it down. Sometimes you're not very spiritual, but if you position yourself next to somebody who's prayerful and you refuse to budge, you'll make it. That doesn't mean you're very spiritual, but you're positioning yourself where the blessing is. This woman was not a very godly woman, but she refused to leave Job's side. Look at what she said. Dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this, did not Job sin with his lips? He didn't sin with his lips. He retained his integrity in the midst of the greatest of pain that he went through. How is the question? He didn't say, call for the dancing women. He didn't say, pour. Let's hit the bottle together. You have your sorrows, I have mine. The man was a worshipper. The moment the news came, he rose up, did something, showed mourning, and immediately worshipped the Lord. Now his wife is instigating him to use his tongue wrong so he could get killed. Curse God and die. What did he say? You speak as one of the foolish women speaketh. What shall we receive? Good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this, did not Job sin with his lips? Now you may be wondering, how is this possible? He was making a statement, receive good from the hands of God, receive evil from God. Isn't it wrong what he was saying? Please listen. It may be to the ones who know what happened. But in the case of Job, Job didn't know what was happening. But you must understand what statement this man was making was a statement of faith. And I've said it in a different way some time ago. I said, if God was to tell you a lie, because it came out of the mouth of God, it'll be truth. Because he cannot lie. Again, I'm repeating, God was to tell you a lie, because it came out of his very mouth, and his character is that he doesn't lie, it'll be truth. How many times we read the Bible and we think, this is surely a mockery of my circumstance. God says he is good, why am I going through the bad things of life? And it looks like God's lying. God doesn't lie. God doesn't lie. The same with Isaiah 53. I am the Lord that healeth thee in Exodus. Then in Isaiah 53, by the stripes of Jesus you were healed. You look at your life, it doesn't look like you're healed. The devil sits and tells you, see the lie? God is a liar. But God never lies. What he says is truth. Now look at Job's point of view. If God, who is good, gives something that looks like evil to me, it will be good when it comes from his hand. Because he said that earlier in chapter 1. Look at chapter 1. He worshipped in verse 21 and said, blessed be the name of the Lord. What is the name of the Lord? He is good. Good. Because he is good, goodness and mercy follow us. An amazing portion of scripture. And the Bible says, in all this, Job did not sin with his lips. It's amazing that he would father through that very woman who wanted him dead. Children would help him see four generations. That she would remain unnamed when all his daughters would be named, friends would be named, he would be named, she wouldn't be named. I mean, there is a blessing when you pray. God knows your name. God knows your address. God knows who you are. He knows the desires of your heart. Don't be surprised when people sit and crib. And they start yakking with their mouths and start complaining and grumbling and murmuring. Just find out how much time they're actually spending in worship before God. 3 minutes you take for worship. And you just say, let's have an extended time of worship today. They want to know whether you're doing something strange. Because it's strange to them. They've never worshipped God. They're used to praise Jesus, hallelujah, and with that it's over. An extended time of worship is a stranger to them because they haven't ever done it in their lives. It's always presentation of what they require. This is what I require, Lord. This is what I want, Lord. This is what I want to see happen. You want to see yourself blooming where you're planted? Be a worshiper. Be a worshiper. I want to show you this before I close. This man was a worshiper. What was the end of what happened in his life? Studying the scripture clearly makes us understand that this entire ordeal didn't last more than 10 months. Write it down. This entire ordeal did not last more than 10 months. What is the end result? The strong wind blew from the wilderness. But what was the end of Job? Let me read it to you. Having half the wealth he had itself, he was the richest man of the east. Now with a double blessing, must be he became the richest man in the east and the west. Surely. I mean, I'm not just playing. There must be something about double blessing. With a single blessing he had, he was considered the richest man, cattleman of the east. Now with a double blessing from God, surely, this man must have overtaken everyone in the west as well. Job chapter 42. Verse 10. And the Lord turned again the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. See, he never stopped praying. First he was praying for his children. They never made prayer their lifestyle. They were removed. Now his friends made a mistake. They made God look like a big punisher who was taking it out on this man Job because of some crime he had made or done. So he had to pray them. Into what? He had to pray them from a curse into blessing. He had to pray them from sickness into health. So your life of prayer will someday shine forth in all its glory when you start praying for people who are under the curse. Follow, please. Then came there unto him all his brethren. They weren't there earlier. Now the news is going out. This man's prayer is working. And all his sisters, and all they that had been of his acquaintance before, and did eat bread with him in his house. Hallelujah. Now see, who's actually now having celebration with the blessing? Till now his sons were eating and drinking. Can I have an amen? Till now his sons were living it up to the hilt. But now this man had weathered the storm. His prayer life and worship life were impeccable. Of course, in ignorance, when he made mistakes with his mouth, he would seek immediate repentance from God. He said, till now I heard you were this and that from people, but now I see you face to face. So I'm repenting of anything I may have said wrong. Just see the glory of this entire end of this man. Now his house becomes the hub of brothers coming to eat, sisters coming to eat, friends coming to eat. Because that's what the Bible guarantees us. God prepares for us a table in the presence of our enemies. And they bemoaned him and comforted him over all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. Now look at this. Every man also gave him a piece of money, and everyone an earring of gold. He could have started a jewelry shop. All his friends bringing earrings of gold. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. For he had 14,000 sheep and 6,000 camels and 1,000 yoke of oxen and 1,000 she asses. Big homework. Homework that had never ever been submitted to me till today. Sad but true. I told the church folk who listened to me, go back, find out the cost of one bull, present day cost, one goat, present day cost. Calculate how much it must be the total wealth of this man. Present day camel, Indian camel or Arab camel. Obviously, this man was not having Indian camels. He was having Arabian camels. Arabian camels, according to Brother Stephen, when he told us, the rate is how much? 3 crores. Now you sit and calculate his wealth. This is my challenge to you, because you have a problem with wealth. You write it down. You bring it before God and say, in your word you said this. This is today's standards of living. In those days it must have been something equal to this, because he was the richest man of the East. Now I want an answer to my understanding of how wealth comes. Somewhere I am understanding it wrong. Somewhere I have made you look like a god of poverty. I want you to do this, and if you are sincere, you will see God bless you. I am again repeating. It's a homework which nobody has ever completed. 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, so that's 3 crores into 6,000. Sometimes your calculator won't be able to calculate. I mean, I think that's one reason why people have not come out with this. And 1,000 yoke of oxen. Yoke of oxen. Two. This is not one. Two. And 1,000 she asses. Didn't say 1,001. We'd have to assume it was Job's wife. Because she was one of the foolish women. Blabbering. Curse God. Die. Then anyhow, make a note of this please. And 1,000 she asses. He had also 7 sons and 3 daughters. And he called the name of the first Jemima, and the name of the second Keziah, and the name of the third Karen Hapapu. And in all the land were no women found so fair as the daughters of Job. I mean, just because he went through a kind of horrible condition with his skin. I want you to write this down. Not one of his daughters were marred. When God blesses, my friends, he takes care of every smallest detail of our life. Can you imagine this man who was fathering the children, what kind of words that must have gone up by his friends and relatives? We heard Job's wife is pregnant again. Just hope that that awful skin condition doesn't repeat itself. I mean, you shouldn't assume that those days they were more holy than these days. Men have been always sinners. Can I have an amen? Blabbermouths have always blabbered. Sometimes it looks like concern for the individual, but it's not concern. It is an attack against the very nature and the quality of the God we serve. He is good, my friends. Can I have an amen? He is totally good. He is not really concerned about you, he is concerned about your daughters. And that includes children who are going through skin conditions. They can and will be healed. They can and will be healed. There need not be a repetition of any curse that can grab a hold of your children that you may have gone through when you were ignorant of the goodness of God. Your children will be healed and walk in the health of God. I mean, God's not a fool to sit and include the complexion of the ladies. He didn't speak anything of the men though. Because it's always The daughter must be beautiful. So the concern is always there in every generation. How did God bless these women? There were no women found so fair as the daughters of Job. And their father gave them inheritance among their brethren. He was blessed so much that even before Christian laws came on the scene, he was blessing all the children equally with inheritance. After this lived Job 140 years and saw his sons and his sons' sons, even four generations. So Job died being old and full of days, but it didn't say he died senile. It didn't say he was bedridden. It didn't say he had bed sores. I mean, when we serve the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, when we read our Bibles, we need to come before God and say, what you didn't give him, don't give me. So when you talk about blooming where you're planted, you must understand there is a reason behind which God speaks a word like that to us. It takes time. Just imagine if Job had moved away where he was planted in prayer to another lifestyle of drinking. There are people who go through that. A little bit of problems, they write off their walk with God. They're too depressed to pray now. They're too oppressed by the enemy to even think straight. Job would never move from that place of prayer and worship. How was his blessing? He was known as a prayerful man. You get prayed by Job, you'll get healed. You get prayed by Job, you'll start prospering. Because God's with him. He's seen God face to face. Can I have an amen? What other blessing do you have in life? To see God face to face. I mean, by Job's confession, that's what happened to him. All of us go crazy when we read about how Moses saw the backside of God. But here's a man who saw God face to face. More than the back, I'm interested in the face. What about you? More than the back, I'm interested in the face. Because that's where the origins of favor come from. His face on my face. His light on me. I am enlightened. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Don't play with what you have heard this morning. This is not a story. Because the storms of life are not a story. When they begin to blow, they all of a sudden come like it's coming from the wilderness. You must make it. You must stand. You must be able to say, God, you're good at all times. There is no evil in you. These are not men who were supernatural men. Very ordinary flesh and blood men. But they knew a supernatural God who would never not fail them. He would not fail them. He would not forsake them. He would always be with them. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. And I want you to believe that the Lord who is good will do mighty things. Mighty things in your life for His glory. You came here to pray. I want you to pray. You came here to seek the face of God. I want you to seek the face of God. You came here to worship Him. Worship Him. Maybe you came here preoccupied with some problem in your life. Well, put it before the Lord and pray. He is our deliverer. He is our strength and our shield. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are saved. I want you to place it before the Lord and pray. Bind the forces of darkness when you pray. I said, bind the forces of darkness when you pray. Take the victory through the blood of the Lamb. Your God is special, my friends. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last. Oh, Shabarabalabari Yantra.
In Make this time of prayer a very, very special time before the Lord. Men may have said a lot of things about you. Don't think your case is a peculiar case. They said it about Job as well. Almost all his friends except one found fault with him. No wonder Job would have to call them miserable comforters. He said, I thought I'll get comfort from you. I didn't get anything from you. The scripture tells us in Psalm 27, when your father and your mother forsake you, then the Lord will take you up. Sometimes it's close people who rise up against us. Shouldn't surprise us. Because if you plant yourself with God, you are with the best company possible. He will not fail you. He will not forsake you. Worship and prayer is the hallmark of the Christian believer's life all the time. If you are heavy in your heart, go before the Lord in prayer. Let His word bathe you in love and comfort continually. Be like the Psalm 1 man. Don't move away from God. This is a time for you to make your commitments. This is a time for you to pray the right kind of prayers. Don't pray vague prayers. Pray word prayers. Word prayers. Have your Bibles open. Pray a word prayer. If you are having a prayer point that you want the Lord to do something about, pray a word prayer. The God who provided Job health, wealth, and family life all over again will do it. In your lives as well. Health, wealth, children, they all were provided by God. God's provision will never fail you. Man's will. God's wisdom will never fail you. Man's will. Earthly anointings will fail you. There are earthly anointings. Those anointings are based upon the petty gods people serve, one of which is mammon. But God's anointing will not fail you. God's unction will not fail you. That unction will lead you into all truth. That unction will bring before your eyes the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That unction will bless the name of the Lord through your lips. That unction will cause you to walk as more than a conqueror. That unction will help you overcome in life every step of the way, every examination. No matter what your age is, every examination you face, you will overcome. God will stand with you. God will prosper you. God will make His face to shine upon you. When you don't have answers to questions, the unction will give you the answer you're craving for. Mama Rabba Shaba Rabba Laba Haryantra. Kabaraba Laba Shantra Baharya. If your friends are constantly saying, curse God, remember they are no friends. They are enemies of the gospel. They will not have a hold on your life. The unction of God will. Kabaraba Shaba Rama. All the time if they're debating your faith, remember you don't debate God. You don't debate God. You don't debate His word. You believe His word. You believe in Him. Mama riba shatra baharya. Sometimes there are your colleagues who sit next to you in your cabin. All the time if they are debating God, don't join them. Because you can't debate God. Don't even sit and think, well, I'm trying to somehow convince them. You can't convince a mocker. You can't convince a scorner. But you can pray that God will bring conviction. By debates, no one are won. Many are won through prayer. You're on your knees before the Lord, looking to Him for miracles. You will see miracles manifest. You will see miracles manifest. God is a specialist in doing miracles. Be of good cheer. Give yourself time to bloom where you're planted. Let your roots go deep so your fruit will be seen and enjoyed by all. Mama Rabba Shaba Rabba Laba Yada Rabba Laba Shondoro Ho Riba Rabba Laba Lebe Riba Shandarahi Namaranto Koboro Hola Shaba Rabba Laba Rika Mara Balaba Nadu Rabba Laba Shandara Balaba Haria. And I want you to know that there is an ongoing blessing of increase that God gave Job that is very rarely thought about. Along with the miracle of wealth, there must have been miracles happening in the families of his faithful servants as well. His cattlemen, his servants, their families, ongoing blessing. Your workers will be blessed who work with you. Kabarama laba riba 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 raba laba shoborobo sikalara deria. Because they stick with you. They may not be spiritual men or women. But if they say, where you go, I'll go. Where you be, I'll be. We will not move even though the storms are blowing. Then they will see the blessing of remaining loyal and faithful. Kabarama laba shadara balaba. Yondorobo lobo shubariba sikalaba. Yadaraba laba riba shoborobo horiantra. You're not here by ordinary appointment. You're here by divine appointment. You've heard words that the Spirit of God wanted you to hear. Now take what you've heard and share it with others. Share it with others. You may not become a preacher, but you can be a person who gives the good news to people. That your God is alive. That your God is good. That He'll do miracles to the ones who stay connected with Him and fellowship with Him in worship and prayer. There can be no turning the dial down on worship and prayer. Mama riba raba raba hari antra bo shubha raba zikayala. Pray in the Spirit this morning. If you haven't received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, make it a point to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit this morning. Say, God, I'm going to plunge myself where the rivers of living water are flowing. And I received the baptism of the Holy Ghost by faith this moment. In the mighty name of Jesus. And having said that, begin to pray in the Spirit. Pray with other tongues. Pray in that heavenly unknown language God wants you to have. Mamariba Shatraba Harya. Those who have been baptized in the Holy Ghost, I want you to lift up your voices and pray in the Spirit. Bless the Lord in the Spirit. Worship the Lord in the Spirit. Don't remain silent. Some of you are muttering something out. Pray loudly in the Spirit. Don't remain silent at a time such as this. Shabaraba di rabalaba hariyantraba lamariba shoborobolobo horia. The Spirit of God is here this morning. Kabaramalaba riba 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 rabalaba shutrobo raba shantraba haria. Nadurabalaba shudaraba sikalaba. Yantoro ho ribara balaba riantra brahayala ekamara balaba hariantra ebara balaba shoboro bolobo riantra leberiba shatra baharia raba shatra boho riantra leberiba rabara balaba riba shondoro horia naduru balaba shatra baharia. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Lift up your voice and pray in the spirit. Pray with other tongues. Pray with other tongues. Pray with other tongues. Hallelujah. Pray loudly, pray boldly. Worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Kadara balaba, shandara balaba. Yodi rabalaba, rikambrana mari antra. Leberibo shotro bohoria. Yambabari bababari bababari ba shotro bohoria. Nadara bababari barabalabari antra bohoria. Kamara balaba, shatara bolabohori antra. E barabalabari kabara balaba. Shabadira malabari antra bohoria. Liberi barabalabari kambranta kamimo robolobo. Shabarabalabari antra. Kabarabalabari bashutra baharia. Yantarabalabari antra baharia. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Whatever desire you're having this morning, I want you to place it before the Lord and tell Him, this is what I desire. This is what I'm praying and believing for. Oh Lord, let there be a difference between the ones who walk in light and the ones who walk in darkness. Let there be a difference between the ones who worship You and the ones who don't worship You. Let there be the difference, oh God, in the ones who pray and the ones who don't pray, oh Lord. In business, in every walk of life, O Lord, let that difference be drawn firmly this year, O God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Kabarabalaba Shatra Baharia, you said restoration, rebuilding, re-rewards in travel. Kabaramalabariba Shatra Bahoria, and renewal. Let there be renewal in the hearts of Your people. Renewal in their hearts this day. Kabaramala bariba shoboro bolo boriba yantra bahari yantra horia. Kabadira mala basha barabalaba yandara heri baba bahoria shabarabalaba rikambrana marabalaba. The mighty name of Jesus, I want you to pray for tomorrow's worship services, for the other brethren who will be coming in. Some of them you know, some of them you don't know, some may be strangers to you. It doesn't matter, pray in the spirit. That's the advantage we have. When we pray in the spirit, God takes over. God helps us pray the will of the Father through the Spirit of God dwelling on the inside of us. I want you to pray for us who minister here. Musicians, for me, for the others who help in the ministry of helps, I want you to pray God's anointing to be rich. Pray that we'll have new souls added to this church. Pray in the mighty name of Jesus for new souls to be added to this church. For the anointing to break every yoke of bondage and to set the captives free. For people who attend this service for the first time, to remain committed to this place. Pray specifically, my friends. Kabara balaba, shandara balaba, yadara balaba, rikamara balaba, haryantra, shamurubolo horyantra baharya, labariba shatra baharya. I want you to pray and believe that the seed that was sown towards the work of the Gideons, towards the construction of the prayer tower in Delhi through the Jesus Calls ministry, I want you to believe that the Lord God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob will prosper the seed. 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 I want you to pray. Lift up your voices and pray. You got to believe it comes back. Good measure pressed down, shaken together and running over. God is a God of harvest. God is a God of blessing. God is a God of increase. And as we have started our teachings on the harvest, I want you to understand that the testimonies we are hearing is no coincidence. It's not coincidence. It is God's appointment with His people. He said, you will fund the gospel in the end times. Your finances will increase. Don't let the devil lie to you. You won't have money. You will have money. You will have the wealth of God. I wanted to say amen to what I'm saying. Secondly, your needs will be met. You will run into debt. You will come out of debt. You will come out of debt. You will not run into debt. You will come out of debt and you will stay free from debt. And number three, you will have enough and more to give out to others joyfully. You will have enough and more to give out to others joyfully. This is the same way we made our declaration on the first of the year. On the four things that God said He would do. And God is doing it. God is fulfilling it. The same way He will do. Mama Rabalaba Shatra Baharya. You will come out of debt. Kabarima Chandra Hora Hala Haryantra. 5 weeks ago, we had a prophetic word here by the word of knowledge. And this was a small group of people like who are here. And I said that the spirit of suicide is bound in the name of Jesus. And I didn't even know who I was talking to. After the service was over, a young man introduced his uncle to me that just come. I know the young man, but I didn't know his uncle. And he said, this man has gone through loss of business to the tune of 6.5 crores. And 1 month ago, he nearly committed suicide. I wanted to believe that God knows what's happening in the midst of large crowds, small crowds. But one thing He knows, His people will come out of debt. His people won't run into debt. They will come out of debt. And I want you to believe that when you're praying this morning. I want you to confess it with your lips. I will not go into debt. It's a commitment you make. You have to make that commitment. Because always there's a desire to run into debt. You have to believe, no, I will not run into debt. I live free from debt. And God will provide every step of the way. His word will stand true. That I will lend to many nations, not borrow. I will lend to many nations, not borrow. I will lend to many nations, not borrow. Kabarabala Haryantra Bohorya. I will lend to many nations, not borrow. Millions will pass through these hands, O Lord. I believe it. I confess it. I speak it forth. And I make my faith proclamation, O Father, in your name. In Jesus' 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 name. Hallelujah. Oh, Rabba Shatra Baharya. Oh, Rabala Bariantra Baharya Kabolo Horya. Shamarabala Bariantra. Shadarabala Bahoriantra Bahoria. Nadurabala Bashatra Baharya. Keri Barabala Balabala Rikamara Balaba. Shomorubolo Boriantra Brahayala. Ladurabha Shatra Baharya. Kaderi Branamo Shantra Baharya. Kabala Bariantra Bohoria. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. God, you're good and your blood mercy, they endures forever, oh God. God, you're good and your blood mercy, they endure forever. God, you're good and your blood mercy, they endure forever. God, you're good and your blood mercy, they endure forever. God, you're good and your blood mercy, they endure forever. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. During this time of the harvest, if you have lost money for any reason earlier, I want you to put it before the Lord right now, if you know how much you have lost. And believe that you will get back everything that you have lost, double. May it look like a very tall statement I'm making when it looks like you won't get back what you lost. But I'm going to ask you to believe along with me, since we bragged about God who prospered Job double, that you will get back every single penny you gave out and which didn't come back. Sometimes you loaned it out to some friend or to some relative or to some person in time of crisis, but they have coolly and conveniently forgotten to repay you back. I'm going to believe along with you, if you will join your faith with mine, to believe that you will get back what you lost double. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I am exercising faith over that unclean situation in your children's lives. The money that they have lost, oh Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, oh Lord, I pray that you will make it up to them double in the name of Jesus. I command it to be loosed. I command it to come forth. I command that bad debtor to come under such conviction right now in the name of Jesus. Such conviction in his heart that he understands he's under a curse till he repays the money, oh Father. In the mighty name of Jesus. 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 I'm commanding, oh God, deep conviction on that person who's taken the loan, cash loan, conveniently tried to walk away with the money, making use of the goodness of your children, oh Father. I command that individual, whoever it is right now, in the name of Jesus, to come under such conviction that they understand that they are under a curse, oh Father, till they repay, in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh Lord, I'm not playing. I am decreeing it this day and I'm calling it done in Jesus' name. I am decreeing it this day and I'm calling it done in Jesus' name. What rightfully belongs to your children, belongs to your children. They're your children, and the wealth that you have entrusted into their hands is for them to have and to enjoy. Because we believe that an earthly man like Job, who gave an inheritance to his daughters and sons, can't outbeat a good God. In the mighty name of Jesus, money that has to come back to your children, command it to be loosed this day. Lord, I'm praying and asking in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, every bad, outstanding money, debt, right now in the name of Jesus, I command its power broken. I command the money to flow. I call it forth in the name of Jesus. I want you to agree, as you're praying along with me, I want you to name that amount. And I want you to command it to be loose this day. Command it to be loose this day. That's what I mean by saying join your faith with mine. Join your faith with mine. I am sensing a supernatural faith from God flowing in my heart this morning. I am sensing a supernatural faith of God flowing in my heart this morning. The gift of faith in operation. I said the gift of faith in operation. The gift of faith in operation. And I'm praying in Jesus' name. I want you to command the money that you have to get double to be loosed back. Double to be loosed back in the name of Jesus. And I want you to note the date and the time. 12:20. 12:20. The 18th of July 2009. We decreed it. And we are going to command that it comes forth right now in Jesus' name. Come forth in Jesus' name. Come forth in Jesus' name. Satan, you liar. Take your hands of God's property. Take your hands of God's property. We're not asking you, we're commanding you. We're commanding you in the authority of the name of the one who said, I am the all-sufficient one. In the name of El Shaddai. In the name of El Shaddai. The all-sufficient God, the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. The King of glory. I command in Jesus' name. I command that a bad repayer will come under such conviction, oh God. Such conviction that they will begin to give back to your children what rightfully belongs to them in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that they will come to you when the miracle happens. That they will continue to brag about the God who blessed Job twice over. In the mighty name of Jesus. And we want to hear miracles about what you're doing, oh Father. We want to hear miracles of how the increase came. We want to hear miracles of how the increase came. They will never have lack in their lives. They will always have plenty, oh Father. I am decreeing it this day. And I call it done in the name of Jesus. I call it done in Jesus' name. I call it done in Jesus' name. I call it done in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Whatever may be the amount. Again I'm repeating. Whatever may be the amount. You gave it out in good faith. It's not come back to you as it. It's going to come back. I said it's going to come back. That individual will be under such conviction by the Spirit of God. That person will understand that till he or she repays what belongs to you, they're under a curse. They cannot run away from the Spirit of God and the conviction of God's Spirit in their lives in the name of Jesus. 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 There's such a supernatural gift and operation this morning, and I want you to know it'll happen for the glory of God. It'll happen for the glory of God. I'm not speaking this from my mind. Because I don't know exactly how much people owe you. If I'm to rationalize, I will sit like you and think, well, how will all this happen? But I know that the gift of faith, when it's in operation, it will come to pass. It will come to pass in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Father, we bless your name. And we give you thanks and praise.